Hello and welcome to Insight Ophthalmology. I'm Dr. Amrit and today we'll be diving into the key clinical features of epithelial and subepithelial corneal dystrophies. This session is designed to be useful whether you are just starting out or preparing for your exams. We'll walk through all the high yield points in a way that's clear, practical, and exam oriented. In our previous video, we introduced epithelial and subepithelial corneal dystrophies and their classification. These dystrophies are grouped based on the morphology and genetic evidence. Within this category, there are six types, but today we'll be focusing on the four that are most clinically important. First, a quick update. The epithelial recurrent erosion dystrophy is no longer considered a separate entity in the latest IC3D classification. It now falls under the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy. Okay. Also, if you remember, I had earlier placed subepithelial mucinous corneal dystrophy in category 1. So here's a correction. According to the most recent changes, it is now in the category 4. So keep that correction in mind. Now, let's dive into the first and the most important one, that is the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy, abbreviated as the EBMD. It's also known as the Map-Dot-Fingerprint Dystrophy or the Cogan's Dystrophy. So let's see what happens here. The basal epithelial cells produce an abnormal multilaminar basement membrane in the Cogan's dystrophy. Now, instead of guiding the epithelial cells upward towards the surface, this faulty basement membrane traps them within the epithelium. And over time, these trapped epithelial cells will degenerate, forming small cysts, what we clinically see as the microcyst. On slit lamp examination, the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy has some classic morphological patterns. These are maps, fingerprints, dots, and blebs. First of all, let's discuss what are maps. So maps are these sharply demarcated grayish geographical areas with clear zones in between. The fingerprints, on the other hand, are parallel concentric lines created by the misdirected or reduplicated basement membrane. They are best appreciated on retroillumination. So maps and fingerprints, they both are a result of the abnormal basement membrane. Then we have dots, which can also be called as microcysts. These are small grayish-white, putty-like intraepithelial opacities, which are caused by degenerated trapped cells. Okay, so sometimes they can also undergo degeneration and form cysts, so they can also be called as microcysts. The less common morphological or clinical feature or clinical presentation is that of the blebs. Blebs are small mound-like opacities visible again on retroillumination, and they represent abnormal fibrogranular or thickened basement membrane material. Now, on fluorescent staining, you may also notice negative staining. This happens because the irregular basement membrane and the trapped epithelial cells will elevate the overlying epithelium, creating folds, and these will appear as dark patches or dark lines against the surrounding green fluorescence. So to quickly summarize the four features, we have maps, which are grayish geographical pattern. We have dots, small putty-like opacities from degenerated cells. Then we have the fingerprints, which are parallel concentric basement membrane lines. We have blebs, which are mound-like, less common opacities. Together, these features will give you the EBMD and its characteristic appearance. That is why we call it Cogan's Map-Dot-Fingerprint Dystrophy. Now let's talk about why patients with EBMD actually develop their symptoms. Now, because the basement membrane is abnormal here, the epithelial cells can't form proper adhesions both between themselves and with the underlying layers. So, in other words, the desmosomes and the hemidesmosomes are defected. So, when these weakly attached cells and cysts will migrate to the surface, they don't anchor them securely. And what is the result? The result is an erosion. And often these erosions are recurrent and therefore they are known as recurrent corneal erosion. This is exactly what gives patients their most common complaint. So patients with epithelial basement membrane dystrophy are going to come with sharp pain, usually on waking up in the morning because the eyelids stick to the loose epithelium at night. Also, they will have blurred and fluctuating vision. And they might also complain of photophobia, tearing, and foreign body sensation because of the abnormal epithelium. Interestingly, many times by the time the patient presents in the clinic, the erosion has already healed, so you may not actually catch the epithelial defect on examination. Now, a key clinical nugget here is that bilateral recurrent corneal erosions, whenever you find it in the absence of trauma, you should strongly consider EBMD or epithelial basement membrane dystrophy. About 10% of the patients experience recurrent erosions, and these often start in the third decade of life, while on the other hand, many others will remain completely asymptomatic throughout the life. All right, so finally, some high yield facts to remember about the Cogan's dystrophy. Number one, it is the most common anterior corneal dystrophy. This is commonly asked in exams. Also, you should know that most cases of this Cogan's dystrophy are sporadic, but there are some autosomal dominant familial forms as well, making this an exception to the usual definition of dystrophies that all dystrophies are hereditary. Regarding the prevalence of this EBMD increases with age. In fact, studies show that about 76% of the patients are above the age of 40 to 50 years. So that is again one point you should remember. So just remember that typically it's considered a condition of middle age. As for complications, we already know the hallmark complication of EBMD is recurrent corneal erosions, and chronic and repeated erosion will however lead to subepithelial fibrosis, because ultimately there's multiple erosion, there will be fibrosis in the epithelium, so that causes scarring. Now, because of scarring, because of abnormal epithelium, patient can have irregular surface that can lead to irregular astigmatism, and there might also be progressive vision loss from scarring and corneal haze. Diagnosing epithelial basement membrane dystrophy is pretty simple and straightforward based on the clinical features that you see. However, you can also carry out an anterior segment OCT. As you can see over here in the first picture labeled as A, you can see irregular and thickened epithelial basement membrane with duplication associated with some undulation and elevation of the corneal epithelial layer. Now, in the second picture, you can see that thickened hyperreflective basement membrane. And in the third one, you can find some hyperreflective dots in the middle of the corneal epithelial layer. Let's talk about the differentials. When you're evaluating a patient with recurrent corneal erosion or irregular epithelium, it's really important to think about differential. First, always rule out trauma-related or post-abrasion erosions. Here, the history will give it away. Patients will often recall an episode of injury. And moreover, the trauma-related erosions tend to be unilateral compared to the EBMD erosions, which are bilateral. Moreover, trauma-related erosions will involve a larger area and they take much longer time to heal. By contrast, the EBMD is bilateral, although it can be asymmetric, and it shows small micro erosions that heal fairly quickly. Second, you have to distinguish the EBMD from other dystrophies like Meesmann's corneal dystrophy. Here you will see true intraepithelial cysts like tiny, round, bubble-like clear cysts which are clustered in the epithelium. They can be present since infancy. Now, in EBMD, on the other hand, we notice that the dots are more scattered. They are putty-like, grayish-white opacities that represents the degenerated epithelial cells and usually noticed later in the adulthood. Then we have the Rice-Buckler dystrophy as the Rice-Buckler dystrophy as a differential. This also has an earlier onset and it can also present with erosions. That's why it is on the differentials. However, on the slit lamp, you will see reticular or lattice-like subepithelial fibrosis and not the multilaminar basement membrane changes of the EBMD. So the classic Map-Dot-Fingerprints will be absent here. Now let's move on to the management of EBMD. Most mild cases respond well to the lubricating ointments and artificial tears, which keep the cornea moist and reduce friction between the eyelid and the epithelium. Now, remember, the drier is the epithelium, the more likely it is to stick to the lid and peel off during blinking and waking up. Now, another option is hypertonic saline drops or ointment. This also works osmotically. So it draws out the excess fluid which is trapped in the abnormal basement membrane and microcyst, and thereby it improves the epithelial adhesion. In cases of recurrent erosions, band-aid contact lenses can also be used temporarily. They protect the fragile epithelium from eyelid movement and also allow healing. But remember, these are all short-term solutions since prolonged wear will increase the risk of infection even with the band-aid contact lens. Now, if not this, medical adjuncts can also help. Topical corticosteroids can reduce inflammation, while oral doxycycline acts as a matrix metalloproteinase inhibitor, stabilizing the basement membrane and reduces the further breakdown of adhesions. It is this matrix metalloproteinases which basically bring about breakdown of the extracellular matrix and therefore weakens the epithelium and the stroma. So to summarize, mild EBMD, you give lubricants and hypertonic saline. In recurrent erosions, you can give them bandage contact lens, steroids and doxycycline. You have to always think about the differentials. Now let's quickly go over the surgical options that are available. Now these are considered when medical therapy isn't enough or when recurrent erosions start to significantly affect the vision. Number one is epithelial debridement with or without a diamond burr polishing. Here, the abnormal multilaminar basement membrane is mechanically removed. We basically need to remove all that abnormally growing basement membrane. So you use a diamond burr that can help smoothen out the Bowman's layer and remove the residual fragments, creating a clean surface for healthy epithelial cells to reattach. The second option is that of anterior stromal puncture. Now this is done for recurrent erosions, but important thing is that it should be done only outside the visual axis. So here we make tiny punctures. They are made in the Bowman's layer and the superficial stroma, and this encourages stronger adhesion points between the epithelium and the stroma. So remember, don't attempt this in the central cornea as it can cause visual disturbances. Then we have the phototherapeutic keratectomy. This is an option when erosions involve the visual axis, and you can use the excimer laser. See, The logic over here is that whenever the erosions are in the visual axis, you don't want to mechanically treat it, or you don't want to do an anterior stromal puncture or put a burr over there, because anything mechanical is imprecise. So you can do a phototherapeutic keratectomy, which might be more accurate and precise, and therefore selectively ablate the abnormal superficial basement membrane and microcysts while preserving the underlying stroma. So this results in a smoother corneal surface, reduce irregular astigmatism and improved vision in these patients. And very extremely rare in EBMD is the keratoplasty. It's only considered in severe cases with scarring, dense haze, where vision cannot be restored otherwise. All right, so that was about the epithelial basement membrane dystrophy. I'll leave you with an MCQ, which is a very high yield question. So which of the following procedure is contraindicated in a patient with epithelial basement membrane dystrophy? So if you know the answer, you can give the answer in the comment section. And that brings us to the end of this video. Don't forget to subscribe to Insight Ophthalmology. In our next video, we'll be discussing the other three epithelial basement membrane dystrophy, and the video will be released soon. So that's all for today. I hope you enjoyed it. If you're interested in joining our memberships for exclusive content, you can find the membership link in the description at the end of the video. Thank you and have a nice day.